Hello everyone. In this session, I am going to discuss about the fast decoupled load flow technique. You can say this as a simplified version of the Newton-Raphson method. Okay. So in Newton-Raphson method, we have got the relation delta P, delta Q with respect to delta del and delta mod V. So based on that, we have got dou P by dou del and dou P by dou mod V, dou Q by dou del, dou Q by dou mod V, right? In Newton-Raphson method, we have checked is there any real power changes with respect to phase angle or the voltage magnitude. Similarly, what about the effects of reactive power with respect to phase angle and the voltage magnitude? In this fast decoupled load flow method, what we are going to do is, we are telling that the real power changes are primarily governed by the phase angles, not on the voltage magnitude. Similarly, the reactive power changes are primarily affected by the voltage magnitudes, but not on the phase angle. So that means there is a decoupling effect between the real power and the voltage magnitude, and there is a decoupling effect between the reactive power and the load angle. That means these values are not changed much because of this voltage magnitudes, and this reactive power will not depends on this voltage angles. Now our problem has become very simple. If you observe this Jacobian matrix, in that case what happened here? So you can neglect this. That means this will not have any significance, and similarly this will not have any significance in this Jacobian matrix. So thereby in this, these two values we are considering it as a zero. So you will be studying only the relation between dou P by dou del and dou Q by mod V. So thereby, as compared to your NR method, the fast decoupled method will be easy, simpler. Why? Because J2 and J3 elements have become completely zero. So now you will have only the J1 and the J4 elements, right? So that is why the name has come fast. This is simple and easy, but since we are taking some approximations here, because practically it is not exactly zero, but it is very a small value as compared to these two relations. So that is why it is like one way we are taking some approximations in this fast decoupled method. That is why NR method will be a bit complicated, but it is accurate method because we are not going to take any approximations there. But in the fast decoupled method, as compared to NR method, the converging process will be very fast, and the convergent computation time also will reduce, and memory also will reduce. But the problem is here, as compared to NR method, the fast decoupled method is less accurate. Okay, to improve the accuracy, what we have to do is, we have to increase the number of iterations. These are the few comparisons about the NR and the fast decoupled load flow method. If you have gone through this NR technique, there we have used the polar form. Whenever you are working with the load flow analysis, it is better to use the values in terms of the polar instead of the rectangular form. But in this fast decoupled load flow technique, we are using the rectangular form instead of the polar form. Okay. So why we have to use the rectangular form? Why we are not using the polar form? Let us see. Let us see few points related to the fast decoupled load flow method. The change in the real power is primarily governed by the changes in the voltage magnitudes, but not in the voltage magnitudes. That is what just now I have told you. So the real power changes will depends only on the phase angle, but not on the voltage magnitude. Second point is, the changes in the reactive power, that is delta Q, is primarily governed by the voltage magnitudes, but not on the phase angles. These two statements now we are going to prove. Okay, so to prove these two statements, we are going to take some of the assumptions. So let us see what are the assumptions that we are going to take. So first one is, We are considering the system is under steady state. Okay, under steady state operation, always we know that the voltage magnitudes will be equal to 1 per unit. Okay, what we are going to do? So, we are assuming the system is under steady state operation and the voltage magnitudes of all the buses are nearly equal to 1 per unit. And the second point is, since the transmission lines are mostly reactive, the conductances are quite small as compared to the susceptance value. So, if you see any transmission line, usually we will consider the transmission line as a, it is predominantly in reactive nature. If you say in terms of the impedance value, you can represent it as a R plus Jx. Okay, since we are working with the admittance in the low flow studies, you can represent this as a G plus Jb, right? In impedance form, if I say R is very much less than X, means in the admittance form, I can say G is very much less than B, right? That is the condition here I have taken, because we are using the admittance form. So, I have represented the statement as, since it is a mostly reactive in nature, the conductances of these lines are very much less than the susceptance value. So, this is the one of the point that we have considered for the simplification. Now, the third point is, under normal steady state operation, the angular differences among the bus voltages are quite small. So, why? Because in the first point, if you see, we have considered under steady state condition, all the bus voltages are maintaining at a 1 per unit. So, that means if you consider any bus voltage under steady state condition means, okay, let me consider this as a transmission line. Okay, let me say P and the Q value. Voltage magnitude P at an angle del P value. And this is voltage magnitude Q at an angle del Q value. So, we are considering the voltage as a V suffix P and V suffix Q are equal to 1 per unit. And if you take the difference between the angles, that is delta Q minus delta P, approximately equal to 0 degrees. So, the next point is, the injected reactive power will be always less than the reactive power demand. Why? Because most of our loads will be inductive loads. Inductive loads will always consume the reactive power. So, we are considering that the reactive power consumed by the elements are always greater than the injected power. QP refers to the injected power at any bus P. So, these four points we have to consider while doing the derivation. Since you have taken the relation between the conductance and the susceptance values here, we are going to represent the equations in terms of the rectangular form instead of the polar form. Then you can consider these assumptions to simplify the equation. That is the reason that we are representing in the rectangular form instead of the polar form. You will better understand in the derivation. So, let us see that. So, we know from NR method, the changes in the real power and the changes in the reactive power we have represented with respect to delta del and delta mod V. So, you know this is the Jacobian matrix which gives the relation between the real power with respect to phase angle del, voltage magnitude, similarly the reactive power. So, the same thing can be represented as J1, J2, J3 and the J4. These are the sub matrices of the Jacobian matrix. So, let us consider this as a equation number 1. According to the fast decoupled low flow technique, there is a decoupling effect between the real power voltage magnitude. So, this term becomes 0. And similarly, there is a decoupling effect between the real power and the phase angle. So, this matrix also will become 0. So, now we have to prove that how these two matrices are going to become 0. So, let us prove the decoupling effect of J2 and J3 elements. So, let us see the J2 elements. First, diagonal component. So, we know J2 relation is dou P by dou mod V, right? The diagonal element, you know what is the diagonal element? We have seen all these equations in the NR method itself. Now, we are going to represent this equation in terms of the conductance and the susceptance. For that, what we are going to do is, now we are going to split these two terms, Okay, how theta as a one term and then all the delta terms as a one term. So now for that, let us, you know, represent these two as a one term. Okay, so I am going to call this as a and this, you know, del q and minus del p will be taken as a b. This is looking like cos of a plus b. So we know cos of a plus b as cos a cos b minus sin a sin b, right? So now if you split this equation and expand, what you will get? 2 mod v suffix p mod ypp and cos theta pp plus sigma q is equal to 1 to n, q is not equal to p, mod v suffix p mod ypq into, so this complete one you will split. What is that? Cos theta pq cos del q minus del p. This is cos a cos b minus sin a sin theta pq into sin del q minus del p. So this is complete term which is multiplied by mod v suffix p into ypq. So let us rewrite these two equations. So this is the complete equation. This is the equation that we have for cos a plus b. And if you split this equation, this term will come as it is here. Plus up to this term, I am not disturbing. That is the same term will come here. Only the thing is we are going to split this cos a plus b as cos a cos b minus sin a sin b. So now we have to simplify this complete equation. So for that, what we are doing is we are going to represent the admittance triangle. Okay, this admittance triangle can be represented in two ways. One thing is if you consider the admittance value as a G plus JB. So the admittance triangle can be represented as this is the conductance G and this is JB. And here this will be the admittance Y. So here theta can be represented. If you take the conductance value as a G minus JB, then you can represent the admittance triangle as G minus JB and this as a admittance Y. This is theta. So either you represent this way or this way, anything, the equations will not change. I am representing the admittance triangle for this G plus JB. So this is the G, JB and the Y. So now let us consider this as a theta. If you look at this equation, here we have Y cos theta PQ. And if you multiply the same thing, okay, this term will be completely multiplied with this, you know, the cos theta PQ. Similarly, these two values will be multiplied with this sign also, this sign term also, okay. So we have to simplify all those values. For that we need these relations. What are the relations means? What is the cos theta? From this admittance triangle, you can represent the cos theta as a G by Y. So from this cos theta, you can represent the G value as Y into cos theta. So let us represent the sine theta also. Sine theta is B by Y. So from this, you can say the susceptance B as a, it is not Y cos theta, it is Y sin theta. Okay, so G as a Y cos theta and B as a Y sin theta. So now in general way, this is the generalized representation. If you see in this equation, we have theta PQ. Okay, so theta PQ. So what you can represent, the same equation you can represent as cos theta pq is equal to g pq by ypq. Here we have again ypq value, ypq cos theta pq. Here also ypq sin theta pq. So that is why the same triangle I can represent as a, this as a theta pq, this as a gpq, this as a bpq, and here you can say this as a ypq value. So now you can say cos theta pq is equal to gpq by ypq. So therefore the gpq value as a ypq into cos theta pq. Sometimes you need to represent the YPP cos theta PP. So that time what this triangle will be? This will become GPP, this will become BPP, this will become YPP, this will become theta PP. So that time you can say cos theta PP is equal to GPP by YPP. Therefore, GPP will be equal to YPP into cos theta PP. In the similar way, you can write for the sine terms also, with respect to PQ as well as with respect to PP. So let us see that sin theta PQ is equal to BPQ by YPQ. From this you can say BPQ is equal to YPQ into cos theta PQ. Similarly, you can write the sin theta PP is equal to BPP by YPP. Therefore, PPP equal to YPP into sin theta PP. If you know this cos theta and this sin theta, so from this you can write, only the thing is the subscripts are different here. If it is a GPQ, here also you will get YPQ cos theta PQ. If it is a GPP, here also you will get YPP into cos theta PP. Okay, these two equations are derived from this general equation. So finally, these are the equations that we are going to use for the simplification of this equation. Let us see. Now I am going to simplify this equation. 2 mod V suffix P mod YPP cos theta PP plus sigma Q is equal to 1 to N. Q is not equal to P. So this particular term has to be multiplied with the two terms inside the bracket. That is, one is the cosine term, another one is the sine term. So that time what you will have? You will have mod VQ mod YPQ into cos theta PQ into cos of del Q minus del P. Okay. So the second term, if you multiply, so this is one term. Okay. This is one term minus mod VQ mod YPQ into sine of theta PQ into sine del Q minus del P. Right. Now, here you have a YPQ into cos theta PQ and here you have a YPQ into sin theta PQ. So here you can represent in place of YPQ cos theta PQ as a GPQ and YPQ sin theta PQ as a BPQ, right? This will become 2 mod VP mod YPP and cos of theta PP plus sigma Q is equal to 1 to N, Q is not equal to P, mod V suffix Q, GPQ, cos of del Q minus del P, minus mod VQ, BPQ, into sine of del Q minus del P. One of the assumptions we have taken is the del Q minus del P is approximately equal to 0 degrees. Okay. If you substitute here 0 degrees and here 0 degrees, so what will happen? Cos 0 will be 1. So that time you will have only mod VQ and the GPQ term. So here if you substitute, sin 0 will be 0. So this complete B term will become 0. So let us see all these steps. So now this is the equation. If I replace the YPQ cos theta PQ by GPQ and YPQ sin theta PQ by BPQ. So now we know the assumption del Q minus del P is approximately equal to 0 degrees. So if you substitute here, this is cos 0 degrees and this will become sin 0 degrees. That is equal to cos 0 is 1 and sin 0 is 0. So finally the above equation can be represented as dou PP by dou mod VP is equal to 2 into mod V suffix P YPP cos theta PP plus sigma Q is equal to 1 to N. Q is not equal to P. This condition is very very important because we have taken that Q is equal to P term out of the sigma term. Then mod VQ into GPQ. Now you can represent this equation again as 2 mod V suffix P into, here again you have YPP into cos theta PP, which is represented as G suffix PP plus sigma Q is equal to 1 to N. This complete term will come. Okay, Q is equal to 1 to N. Q is not equal to P mod VQ into GPQ, right? So now if you observe this, this complete equation is having the conductance value. So we have taken one more assumption that the conductance is very much less than the susceptance value. That is why this equation will have very very small amount, which you can make it as a approximately zero. So that is why the changes in the real power with respect to the changes in the voltage magnitude will be very negligible, which you can consider it as a zero. So finally you can say, we know G is very much less than V. You can consider dou PP by dou mod VP as a approximately zero. Let us consider this as equation number 2. So if you consider the equation for the off diagonal elements, you will have dou PP by dou mod VQ as mod V suffix P mod YPQ cos theta PQ plus del Q minus del P. Here also if you split this equation, okay, here you consider theta as a one term and del term as a other. So you will have A plus B cos A plus B. Split this equation, we have mod VP mod YPQ. Here you will have a cos B minus sin A sin B, okay. If you observe this equation, here you have a YPQ into cos theta PQ and here we have a YPQ into sin theta PQ. If you multiply, okay, I am explaining you directly here. Now this term you will have a GPQ, okay. So here you have a BPQ. So if you take here 0 degrees, okay, this is 0 degrees and this is 0 degrees. Cos 0 degrees will become 1 and sin 0 degrees will become 0. So completely this term will become 0. So now you will have only, you know, mod V suffix P GPQ value. That's it. Okay. So now we know the GPQ value is YPQ into cos theta PQ that we have already substituted, and we know the G is very much less than B since we have only the conductance part. So that can be approximately consider it as a zero value, right? So therefore the off diagonal element and the diagonal element of the J2 matrix both are equal to zero. So finally what happened? The J2 matrix completely is approximately zero. So that is why we have represented there the J2 matrix as a zero. Now J3 elements diagonal component dou QP by dou del P. So here also we are going to consider this as a, this is A and this is B. So let us split the equation, cos A cos B minus sin A sin B. So now if you simplify this equation, this also I have taken directly here, you can say YPQ into cos theta PQ as a GPQ, and the same YPQ will be multiplied here also. This will become YPQ into sin theta PQ, which is a BPQ. Okay. Wherever you have this sin term of del Q minus del P will become zero. Why? Because del Q minus del P, we have taken it as a 0 degrees. This is also 0 degrees. Now this complete term will become zero. Okay. This will become zero. So this will not come. Now till here you will have an equation. So here also this cosine term is becoming 1. So this YPQ cos theta PQ will become GPQ. So finally you can have this equation dou QP by dou del P equal to sigma Q is equal to 1 to N. Q is not equal to P mod V suffix P mod VQ, and this YPQ cos theta PQ can be represented as GPQ. So you know again this equation is having only GPQ term. So we have a relation, G is very much less than B. So this will be approximately equal to 0. Okay. Let us consider this as equation number 4. Now let us see for off diagonal element. So you have dou QP by dou del Q equation. Here also we are splitting this as a and this as a B. So expand the equation and simplify. So here also you have YPQ into cos theta PQ. If you substitute here also you will have YPQ into sin theta PQ. Okay. This will become GPQ and this will become BPQ. And we know del Q minus del P is 0 degrees. Okay. So sin 0 will be 0. This complete term will go, this sin term. Then you will have only the cosine term. Here this will be 1. So again you will have minus mod V suffix P, VQ and GPQ value. Okay, so this is the value that we are going to get. Then this equation is also having only the conductance value, so we are considering this as a zero. Why? Because it is the conductance is very small as compared to susceptance. Successfully, we have proved that the elements J2 and as well as the element J3 are approximately equal to 0 based on the assumptions that we have taken. Okay. So, with respect to these assumptions only, we are making these two matrices as a 0. Otherwise, these two matrices will have some value but which is very small in quantity. Now, let us consider this equation as 5. Now, if you observe equation number 2 to 5, so the 2 equation is dou PP by dou mod VP is approximately equal to 0, and equation 3 is dou PP by dou mod VQ is approximately equal to 0, and 4th equation is dou QP by dou del P equal to 0, dou QP by dou del Q is approximately equal to 0. So the 2 to 5 equations are proving that the off diagonal and the diagonal quantities of the J2 and J3 elements are approximately equal to 0. This we have considered as a equation 1. Now from equation 2 to 5 we are proving that the off diagonal and the diagonal quantities of these two matrices are approximately 0. So we can replace those two matrices by 0. So now this is the equation that we are using in the fast decoupled load flow technique. Okay, so in the fast decoupled load flow technique, you will get equations only for the submatrices J1 and the J4 instead of all the 4 submatrices. So thereby the complexity of the problem also will reduce. Now let us see the equations for J1 and J4 in terms of the rectangular form. So finally, the load flow technique can be represented as delta P delta Q J1 0 0 and J4 elements. Now let us represent J1 as a dou P by dou del and J4 as a dou Q by dou mod V. So now we are going to find the off diagonal quantity and diagonal quantity of J1, that is dou PP by dou del Q and dou PP by dou del P. Similarly, the diagonal and off diagonal quantities of J4. So let us take this as equation number 6. Now let us see the derivation for J1 matrix diagonal element. Dou PP by dou del P, we know the equation for dou PP by dou del P as like this. So now I have considered here also the theta terms as a 1 term which I am representing by A and the del term as a B. So now here what I am going to do is, here I want to remove this condition Q is not equal to P. So to remove this term means what I have to do, I have to bring the Q is equal to P term into this sigma term, right? So for that, what I have to do, what is the Q is equal to P term here? Let us substitute and see what is the Q is equal to P term you will get here. That is mod V suffix P, mod V suffix P. Okay, if you substitute Q is equal to P. So this is mod YPP, okay, sine theta PP plus del P minus del P, right? This del P will get cancelled. So this mod V suffix P will become mod V suffix P whole square mod YPP into sine theta PP, okay? So this is the term I want to bring inside this sigma term so that I can remove this Q is not equal to P term, okay? So for that, what I have to do, this term I have to add, the same term I have to subtract. Yes or no? Then my equation will not change. The same thing I am going to add one time and subtract one time. So let us do that for this equation. So I am going to represent this Q is equal to P term like this. Okay, mod VP square YPP sine theta PP minus mod VP square YPP sine theta PP plus this complete term. Now what I can do? Okay, this mod V suffix P square YPP sine theta PP, if I send inside this sigma term, then I can remove this condition. Yes or no? Because I am sending that Q is equal to P term into the sigma. So now what will happen? This will become mod V suffix P square mod YPP. Okay, this term I am writing here. Okay, YPP sine theta PP. Sine theta PP plus sigma Q is equal to 1 to n. Now you no need to represent this. Q is not equal to P because now that Q is equal to P term is there inside this sigma term. That's it. Remove this condition and write this equation completely. Sin theta PQ, this will come here. Okay. So now what is this here? Sigma Q is equal to 1 to n mod V suffix P, VQ, YPQ, sin theta PQ plus del Q minus del P. What is this? This is the static load flow equation for the reactive power. Yes or no? This is the reactive power equation at any bus P. But only the change here is, here we don't have any negative sign. That negative sign you will represent minus QP. And this will be minus mod V suffix P square. What is this YPP sin theta PP? You know the susceptance B is equal to Y into sin theta. So that is why it is subscript PP. You will have B suffix PP. That's it. Okay, minus mod V suffix P square BPP minus QP. The reactive power injected into any bus, that is QP, will be very much less than as compared to the reactive power consumed by the system. So that is why we have taken QP is very much less than the mod VP square into BPP. Okay, so that is why this can be neglected. So your equation will have only minus mod V suffix P square into BPP. So this is the final equation that you are going to get. Okay, now let us represent that. This I am representing it as a QP minus mod VP square into YPP sin theta PP. So this can be finally taken as minus QP. So here also you will have a negative sign because QP equation means it is minus sigma Q is equal to 1 to n, like that it will start. Since we don't have a negative sign, this negative sign will come for this QP. Here you can neglect this QP value also because we are assuming QP is less than this term. So finally you have dou PP by dou del P as minus mod V suffix P square into BP. Let us consider this as a equation number 7. Now we are going to see the off diagonal element of J1 matrix. So this is the equation for the off diagonal element. Now we are going to split this equation as sin A plus B. Now we know sin A plus B is a sin A cos B plus cos A sin B. So according to that I have represented as sin theta PQ cos del Q minus del V, similarly cos A sin B. Right, now let us substitute our assumptions. That is, we have assumed delta Q minus delta P as a 0 degrees. Now this will become cos 0 degrees. This particular term will become 1 and sin 0 degrees, this will become 0. So that means this complete second term will not come. So if you take the first term alone, you will get minus mod V suffix P VQ YPQ into sin theta PQ. Okay, this cos 0 degrees, anyway it is 1. If you take this also as a 1, now you will get only these two. Now again we can substitute this value YPQ into sin theta PQ as a BPQ. Yes or no? So from the admittance triangle, you can say this is G and this is B and this is Y. Okay, Y, if you consider this as a GPQ, BPQ and YPQ and this as a theta PQ, you can say sin theta PQ is equal to BPQ by YPQ. So therefore YPQ into sin theta PQ as BPQ. So finally that can be represented as minus mod V suffix P VQ. This complete term can be represented as V suffix PQ. So therefore the off diagonal quantity dou PP by dou del Q as minus mod V suffix P VQ into BPQ. So let us take this as a equation number 8. Now let us see the diagonal and off diagonal equations for the J4 matrix. So the diagonal quantity here, however you have done the diagonal quantity of the J1 element, same thing we have to do here, okay? Here Q is not equal to P term is there. You have to bring the Q is equal to P term into this relation. So first let us see what is the Q is equal to P term. Let us substitute Q is equal to P here. So that is mod V suffix P mod YPP into sine theta PP. Okay, if you substitute Q is equal to P, these two will get cancelled. Okay, del P minus del P. So this is the term you have to bring into this sigma term so that you can remove this condition. Okay, this complete term you can write as minus mod V suffix P mod YPP into sine theta PP. Again, one more time you can write minus mod V suffix P mod YPP into sine theta PP, right? So whatever term we want, that term already is here, okay? This sigma term is anyway negative, so we want a negative sign only. So what you can do, this one term happily we can send inside this sigma term, okay? So you will be left with only one term outside the sigma, one time will go to the inside the sigma term, okay? That is one simplification. Before doing that, what I am doing is, I am going to multiply this completed term by mod V suffix P, okay? So what is the reason why I have taken that multiplication? I will tell you once I finish this derivation, okay? So I have multiplied on the left hand side also by mod V suffix P. On the right hand side, complete equation I have multiplied, that is minus 2 mod V suffix P square YPP sine theta PP. Here also I have included this. Okay, now also that Q is equal to P term we can make, because here also if you take mod V suffix P will become mod V suffix P square mod YPP into the complete sine term. Okay, same thing here we have, so no problem. This I am going to split as minus mod V suffix P square YPP. The same minus 2 times I am going to split into the two equations, and this sigma terms I have written as it is. Now what I can do, one of this term I will take inside this sigma term so that we can remove this condition Q is not equal to P. So after doing that, you will have an equation minus mod V suffix P square. So I have taken directly here, you will have only this term. Okay. So before that, I will write one more step. What is that? Minus mod V suffix P square mod YPP sine theta PP. Okay. Minus. Now what this equation will become? Q is equal to 1 to N mod V suffix P mod VQ mod YPQ into sine theta PQ plus del Q minus del P. So now what is this equation? This equation is QP. So why? Because this equation is having a negative sign also. That is why this is a plus Q suffix P. Now if you come to here, this equation is YP Y into sine theta, which is a susceptance. Okay, subscript is PP minus mod V suffix P square. Now this is the equation finally you will get if you simplify this complete equation. So that is minus mod V suffix P square PPP plus QP. Again, what is the assumption that you have? QP is very much less than mod V suffix P square into BPP. So therefore, you can neglect this term. Now you can write only this term alone. So now by taking the assumption, you will have dou PP by this I can send to the denominator. So that is dou QP by dou mod V suffix by mod V suffix P is equal to minus mod VP square into BPP. Okay. So now I will tell you why I have multiplied this by this equation. So you no need to multiply also. You can cancel this also. If you cancel that, what will happen is here this equation will become dou QP by do mod v suffix p into minus mod v suffix p into bpp. Okay, like this also you can use the equation, but why instead of this equation, why I have taken this equation mod v suffix p by mod v suffix p means, if you look at the J1 matrix diagonal equation, you have dou pp by dou del p is equal to minus mod v suffix p square into bpp. Okay, now if you see for J4 element also we got minus mod v suffix p square into bpp. That means by multiplying this equation, we can retain the same equation. So we can keep the diagonal element equation for both J1 as a J4 element as a common equation. Okay. Just to bring the similarity in the equations, we have taken like this. So if you want, you can use this also. Okay. Now let us consider this equation as a equation number 9. So now let us see for the off diagonal element. We know this is the equation for off diagonal element of the J4 matrix. So we are splitting this into the two terms A and B. So now if you split as a sign A plus B, as a sign A plus B, we have a sign A cos B plus cos A sin B. Now again substitute del Q minus del P as a 0 degrees. Now if you substitute, here you will get 0 degrees, here you will get 0 degrees. This complete term will become 0, cos 0 degrees is 1, and YPQ into sin theta PQ will be equal to BPQ. So in one step, you can represent the equation. So that is minus mod v suffix p into bpq. Let us take this as a equation number 10. If you see this equation, here we got minus mod v suffix p into bpq. If you observe the off diagonal quantity of the J1 matrix, there you got the dou pp by dou del q value as a minus mod v suffix p mod vq into bpq. Okay, now if you see these two equations are almost similar, but only the thing is we don't have this term mod bq. So to bring this term, what we can do, like however you have done for the diagonal element, same thing you can do. What is that? Just multiply this equation by using the mod bq. Okay, so if you multiply this, what you will get? Mod qp by mod vq into mod vq is equal to minus mod v suffix p mod vq into bpq. Okay, now if you multiply this equation by mod vq and mod vq, then these two equations will become same. That means for J1 two equations you will get, and for J4 you will get two equations. Totally you will have only four equations. That four equations also we are making that as a two equations. That is, the diagonal elements of J1 and J4 are same, and the off diagonal element of the J1, J4 are also same. So that is why finally you have to remember only two equations, one for diagonal, one for off diagonal. That is why. So this 10th equation, I can take it as dou qp by dou mod vq by mod vq is equal to minus mod v suffix p vq into bpq. So this you have to consider as a equation number 10. Now from equation 6 we know delta p is equal to delta p, this is the J1 matrix, J1 into delta del. Similarly delta q can be represented like this. Let us consider this equation number 12. Okay, so from equation 11 we can represent the delta p as sigma q is equal to 2 to n dou pp by dou del q into delta del q. Okay, so here q is equal to 2 to n. Usually we will consider the first bus as a slack bus. Now what is the value of this dou pp by dou del q? Means just now we have derived the dou pp by dou del q value as minus mod v suffix p mod vq into bpq. So let us substitute that. That is equal to sigma q is equal to 2 to n minus mod v suffix p vq into bpq, which is multiplied by delta del q. Let us consider this as a equation number 13. So this equation we got from equation number 8. Here this the delta PP will be called as an active power mismatch, and this is the voltage at any bus P. So from this equation, what we are going to do is we are going to bring all the P terms together and all the Q terms together. Okay, so here delta P and delta mod V with respect to bus P we are bringing together, so thereby you will get the delta PP by delta mod V suffix P as this equation. Okay, we have assumed again at the steady state condition, we have considered the voltage magnitudes as a 1 per unit. Okay, except the calculated value, whatever the values that you are using in the equation, you will make as a 1 per unit. So finally, this equation can be represented as this becomes 1 per unit. So you will have sigma Q is equal to 2 to N minus BPQ into delta del Q. In general, so I am going to represent this in terms of the matrix form, delta P by delta mod V as matrix B prime into delta del. Okay, so finally we could bring one relation, that is delta P by delta mod V is equal to B prime into delta L. Okay. This B prime is nothing but minus B matrix, okay, the susceptance matrix. Let us consider this as equation number 14. So from equation 12, delta Q by delta mod V. So this equation can be represented with respect to any bus P as sigma Q is equal to 2 to M dou QP by dou mod VQ delta mod VQ. There we have represented Q is equal to 2 to N. That means for all the buses, whether it is a PQ buses or whether it is a PV buses, you will find the P value, okay, because the P term will be present in both the PQ as well as the PV terms, but this Q you will calculate only for the PQ buses. That is why 2 to M, where M represents the number of PQ buses, okay. So now we have derived dou QP by dou mod VQ value as minus mod V suffix P BPQ into delta PQ. You can consider anything, okay. I have given you the two equations. We have not considered here dou QP by dou mod VQ by mod VQ. Okay, if you consider like that, then you consider here mod VQ. I have not considered here dou mod VQ by mod VQ. Just I have considered the dou QP by dou mod VQ. That is why here that mod VQ term I am not considering, right? So if you represent this again, here this magnitude will become 1 per unit according to our assumption. So this can be represented like this. Finally, in general way, in terms of the matrix notation, that is delta Q by delta mod V is equal to minus B matrix, that is called as a B double prime into delta mod V. Okay, so we have taken the same minus B matrix as a B prime and the B double prime. Why? Because one susceptance matrix we are finding for both PQ as well as the PV buses, and another susceptance matrix we are finding only for the PQ buses. Okay, that is the difference. These both are susceptance matrices only, which is a minus B matrix. So let us consider this as equation number 15. Now here what is the M value? M value represents the number of PQ buses. Okay, as I said, the B prime and the B double prime matrices are nothing but minus B matrix. Okay, negative value of the B matrix. Whatever the B matrix is having, the negative value of that will be considered as a B prime and the B double prime value, which is a constant matrix. Since I am calling it as a constant matrix, it will not go into the iterations. Okay, if you find for one iteration, the same values you can use for the several iterations. Thereby, the computation time drastically reduces for the fast decoupled load flow technique. Okay, so that you can say it can be determined only for the first iteration. So the next one is matrix B prime. Just this point also I have told you, this have to be determined for both PQ as well as the PV buses, and the matrix B double prime will be so determined only for the PQ buses. So the same thing, since it is a constant matrix, it will not go into any iteration process. So that is why this decoupled load flow technique will be faster than the NR method. While doing the B matrix calculations, some of the assumptions we have to consider into the account. Let us see. First one is the representation of the network elements which are predominantly affect the reactive power flows. That is the shunt reactances and the transformer of nominal in phase taps should not be considered while calculating the B prime. Okay. So if you have any shunt admittances, if you consider the transmission line representation, obviously for our load flow studies, we will include that shunt reactance values. Okay. But if you are calculating the B prime matrices, then you have to neglect those shunt reactances, then calculate the admittance matrix. From that, you read the susceptance values. So with the shunt reactances, we are not supposed to form the B prime matrix. Second one, we have to ignore the series resistance also. Okay, so while calculating the B prime matrices, ignore the series resistance and ignore the shunt reactances. If any off nominal tap changes, that also to be ignored. So the next one is, while calculating the B double prime, that is we will calculate this for only the PQ buses. So in that case, if any phase shifters are there, we have to neglect those angle shifting also. Okay, so these are the three points that we have to remember. I hope this is clear. Thank you.